I'll begin recording. Welcome, everybody. Excited to have you in class today. Today's class is all about Article 1 of the Constitution, which is Congress. We started with Congress. We wrote it first. It's the longest section of the original or structural Constitution. And we're here to talk about it in class today. My name is Curry Sautner. I'm the Chief Learning Officer at the National Constitution Center. And I'm here with our top scholar, Tom Bonnelly, who's going to help teach us all the different parts. And we're going to have a million questions for Tom during this class. So if you want to ask a question, please feel free to use the chat or the Q&A. I will check both locations and I'll weave them in as Tom gives us kind of our foundations and gets us straight. So lots to do today, Tom. Are you ready for it?
I'm ready.
Awesome. So there's always a million framing questions, but I think we can start kind of almost with two basic questions around this. Number one, how does Congress work? How is it actually set up to work? And what's its role and job? And then number two, why did the founding fathers set it up this way in the first place? And what were the debates around its structure, its responsibilities, and the power that Congress has, and the limits that are in Congress as well? I think they're the two big starting points. And then I have like five other what ifs for you as we get through the next stages of how Congress is working today.
That sounds great, Curry.
Do you want to start with that Constitution you love so much and we all love?
Yes. Let's start with the text itself. And Article 1 of the Constitution establishes Congress. This, of course, is our nation's legislative branch. It's responsible for making the laws. And it, as Curry said, it's the longest part of the Constitution. It's the part of the Constitution that at the Constitutional Convention, the delegates debated the most. And the reason why is because they expected Congress to be the most important, but also the most dangerous branch of government. So they were looking in creating this new institution to give it more power than the national legislature that came before it in the Articles of Confederation, but they also wanted to be sure that they still placed limits on those powers. So one of the big things they did, and we know this from Article 1 of the Constitution, is they divided the power of Congress between two houses. And so this is the idea of bicameralism. So this is why we have a US House of Representatives and a US Senate. And they also were both organized for different purposes, or at least different forms of representation, with the U.S. House of Representatives being organized by the principle of popular sovereignty. So for each state, the greater its population, the more people within that state, the more representatives it would have in Congress. So the large states have more political power in the House of Representatives, states like California, and smaller ones like Rhode Island or Connecticut. So that's the House of Representatives. Overall, the big theory there is it was supposed to be the part of the government that was closest to the people. There's, you know, looking today, there's 435 members in the House of Representatives. They're elected every 2 years, so they have to face voters. Every 2 years, the representatives can vote, can run for re-election, but in the end, they'd have to come back to the people every 2 years, justify their record, justify being sent to Congress again. So that's the House of Representatives. The Senate, on the other hand, is organized around the principle of equal state representation. So each state gets two senators, whether it's as big as California or as small as Rhode Island. So today we have 100 senators, and their term of office is a bit longer than the House of Representatives. So it's 6 years. And so they can obviously run for re-election as well, but their term will be a longer period of time. And they have certain other responsibilities that members of the U.S. House of Representatives did not have. For instance, they play a role in the treaty-making power, and they also play a role in the nomination process. So the Senate has to either vote yes or no, for instance, to the nominees that presidents have to the Supreme Court. The Senate plays a role there. And then finally, although the original Constitution had U.S. senators elected by state legislatures, following the 17th Amendment ratified in 1913, we now directly elect U.S. senators, so they're elected by the voters. So that's the House and the Senate, Curry. I'll sort of pause there before moving on.
I'm just going to have a 5 minute that I cannot believe it was 1913. So in 1912, we weren't directly electing senators. That feels almost mind blowing to me because they do a lot and they have a lot of power in that Constitution. So can you talk about what's the job and the role of the legislative branch, both the House and the Senate? And where is their powers found in the Constitution?
Yeah, so if you look at the Constitution, Article 1 is really long, but if you want to drill down at the powers of Congress, it's Article 1, Section 8. And so as we're thinking about this, what the framers were really attempting to do with Article 1, Section 8 was to think about what sort of powers do we think are essential for the national government to have? Where is it absolutely essential for us to speak with a single national voice? Where is it absolutely essential to have a single national policy that all states would have to follow? Because remember, for the founding generation, they were trying to strike a balance between a more powerful national government, but also a broader constitutional system where a lot of decisions would still be made by the states. So this is that system of federalism that the founders established, that ongoing debate about which powers go to the national government, which to the states. Article 1, Section 8 begins to answer that question for us. And we see some of the big powers here granted to Congress, the power to lay and collect taxes. Congress didn't have that power under the Articles of Confederation. It did under the new U.S. Constitution, the power to borrow money, the power to regulate interstate commerce. This is the broad power that Congress has to end up setting certain national policies when it comes to the economy, the power to coin money, to establish post offices and post roads, to declare war. So that's another one where we want the national government on the world stage to speak with one single voice for the nation, the power to raise and support armies, to provide and maintain the Navy, and finally, the power to make all laws which shall be necessary and proper for carrying out all of the powers that are listed there. This is often called the elastic clause, but it's where we give Congress some play in the joints. We can't literally list every single kind of law that Congress is going to pass. We wouldn't have a small constitution like this that we can all read and lay claim to as ordinary citizens. And so we end up giving Congress this power to pass laws that are necessary to carry out the other powers that are specifically listed in the Constitution.
And I love how you kind of say that, because sometimes when you first learn about the necessary and proper clause, it feels like the catch-all. You can make any law that you want, but it's really about you can make the laws that are needed to be able to do all those things above. And so going into kind of the next kind of step-by-step process is how Congress works and how we, you know, a bill becomes a law. We kind of look through that process knowing that the only laws that they can make have to be based in those powers of Congress in Section 1, Article 8. So can you walk us through this? And then we'll ask the inevitable question. It definitely seems a little complicated to get things done. Intentional, not intentional, has become more complicated over time. All those questions wrapped in there.
Yeah, so let's start with the process and then we'll back into the theory. So the process itself here, it's laid out perfectly in this infographic where, okay, so how does a bill become a law? Well, first, a bill has to pass both houses of Congress. So the U.S. House of Representatives has to say yes, and the U.S. Senate has to say yes. So those are two different bodies with, you know, different timelines under the original Constitution, different voters. The framers wanted to make sure that both of those bodies said yes to each new bill that passes. But that doesn't end the process. It doesn't become a law just because both houses of Congress pass it. From that point, the bill is then sent to the President of the United States, and the President then gets to say yes or no. The President can sign that bill or the President can veto that bill. And so if the President says yes, signs the bill, that bill becomes a law. That's the end of the process at that point, and the bill becomes a law of the land. The flip side is if the President vetoes that bill, then the bill is actually sent back to Congress. And then Congress, each house has an opportunity to either vote to override the President's veto or not, but the bar is set really, really high. It requires a two-thirds vote in each house of Congress. So that really means in almost all circumstances that you're gonna have to find a group of members of both the US House and Senate of varying views, all deciding that what the president did in this circumstance is wrong. It's a very high threshold, but it still is a check on that presidential power. Overall, what you could already see here is that broader principle of checks and balances. Congress given the power to make the laws, but the president being part of that process to check the Congress if maybe the law's a bad idea, or maybe the president importantly thinks that law's unconstitutional. There's that check in place there from the president. And then finally, even if both houses of Congress pass the law, even if the president signs the law, in the end, ordinary citizens, businesses, organizations, states can still go to court and argue that that law is unconstitutional. When we get to that point, it's that key question that we always have to ask when Congress passes the law. Where is Congress getting the power? Congress, where do you get the power to do this? And we have given the courts then the power of judicial review to decide whether that law is constitutional or unconstitutional, that additional check, that additional backstop, even if Congress and the president say yes.
And the going to the, that's a lot of looping. And there's a lot of looping in there. That's a definitely complicated system. And so was that their intent to begin with, to make it a complicated system? And if so, why?
Yeah, so people complain all the time and have in every generation that Congress can't get anything done. This process is so hard. Look at England. You know, Parliament can move so quickly and get things done. Why do we have this difficult system? Don't we need to fix it and speed it up? And that's an ongoing topic of constitutional and institutional debate. But it's important to realize that this complicated system, it was by design. It was not a bug in the system. It was a feature. And the broader theory here is that by slowing politics down, by making it hard to pass a national law, you could promote deliberation and compromise. Because the only way in which you're often going to get through this complicated system is by having an idea that people of varying views agree is a good idea. And so this is guarding against the danger of what Madison would have called the danger of faction, the idea that just one group of people is going to control the government and control everything. We would say, Madison said faction, we would say political parties, but the idea is that you want to promote deliberation and compromise, and that in the end, by slowing this process down, if you have a bad idea, you toss it out. If you have a flawed idea, you could conceivably make it better. If you have a good idea, you could make it great. And that in the end, if you could survive, if you could run this gauntlet, that hopefully we'd pass national policies that promote the common good. And then finally, the backstop, Curry, is once those policies are passed, the elected officials then have to return to the people and defend their work. And so it's this iterative process between policymaking and elections that lead to really the big theory of our Republican form of government.
Awesome. Thanks. And you're right. There's all these loopings on purpose. Now, Rich had a question about Section 4, allowing Congress to regulate federal elections. And I know we're going to walk through the history now, but did you want to kind of jump in while we're at the constitutional moment, looking at the text, talk a little bit about Section 4?
Yes, Article 1, Section 4, it does two things. One, it says that the time, place, and manner of elections are going to be set by the states, subject, though, to regulation by Congress. And so what this ends up setting up at the founding is kind of a default rule that a lot of big decisions about elections, the nitty-gritty, are going to be set by the states. And this is why we see great variety in voting laws from state by state. But it is a reminder that at the back end, there is the power of Congress to step in and pass voting laws. And what we know from our constitutional history are that so many of the amendments to our Constitution have had to do with rebalancing voting and elections in different ways, whether it's revising the Electoral College, which we get in Amendment number 12, or the various laws that we see protecting voting rights by race with the 15th Amendment, sex with the 19th Amendment, age with the 26th. And so we see sort of a rebalancing and a debate over time about how much power we want the national government to have, how much to the states. The last thing I'll say, Curry, is that Article 1, Section 4 really, really bothered the anti-federalists, those who oppose the Constitution. If you look at those ratifying conventions, it is one of the provisions that they were really, really concerned about. They were concerned with the national government of elites and incumbents basically gaming the system to stay in office. So it's, that's just a little historical aside.
Oh, fun historical aside. So on that note, let's go back to that convention that got a whole bunch of Federals and anti-Federalists chatting afterwards. And walk us through pretty quickly kind of the big plans and debates that they had to go through for building Congress. And like you said earlier, that they want to give enough power so it can get things done. And you can see that in the list of powers, but at the same time, really worried about giving them too much power. And then I can't wait to dive into all the tests that happened over the years. You said before class started, and I thought it was the best line ever, if you want to have one constant in the Constitution, that's, we're always talking about Congress. This has been something that, like, you know, it's not just moments in time. It's always talked about every single generation. So give us our foundation and then we'll dive into the test.
Yeah. So, I mean, again, at the Constitutional Convention, the biggest battles are often over Congress. They spend the most time on Congress. A few of the big topics of debate, let's just tick through them quickly so we can get to the history. You know, one of them is, how are we going to structure Congress overall? So, you know, are we going to have one House of Congress like existed under the Articles of Confederation or more than one? We've already said that the founding generation settled on two houses of Congress, a Senate and a House. That's bicameralism. That's a way to divide power and guard against the dangers of an out of touch, too powerful Congress. We also have debates over representation in the two houses. So we have what was called the Great or Connecticut Compromise, where we decide to have two different houses of government, two different houses in Congress, both organized differently, with the U.S. House of Representatives organized by popular sovereignty and this idea that the more populous states get more representatives, but then also having a Senate that has equal state representation. So whether you're a big state or a small state, you get the same number of senators. This was a battle that almost destroyed the convention. People wanted to walk out on it. In the end, the compromise, we talk about the Great Compromise today, it passed by a single vote. James Madison hated it, but in the end, they'd settle on this. And so this is how we end up with the two houses of Congress organized around those two theories of representation. Of course, another big and tragic compromise that happened in the convention was the Three-Fifths Compromise, where the delegates battled over how are we going to count enslaved people for purposes of representatives in the House of Representatives. The slaveholding states argued enslaved people should count as five-fifths. Even though we're not going to give them any rights, we're not going to give them power, we're going to treat them poorly, they should count as five-fifths for purposes of representation in Congress. That would boost the power of the slaveholding states. Anti-slavery delegates said, no, that's hypocrisy. In the end, we reached the Three-Fifths Compromise, again, largely brokered by Roger Sherman, where enslaved people count as three-fifths of a person for purposes of representation in the House of Representatives. And then finally, Curry, there's big debates over how much power do we want this new Congress to have? We've already talked a little bit about some of the powers that the delegates give to Congress. I think the big point or the big idea to take from this is that the delegates really were trying to figure out what sort of issues are genuinely national issues that require national action, and which issues do we think are best left to the states? What we know is that for the founding generation, many, many of the delegates, many, many of their fellow citizens really wanted to leave a lot of powers to the states. The idea being that state and local governments are the governments that are closest to the people. They're going to be most responsive to the people's needs. So we want the possibility of a lot of decisions being made there, both for purposes of experimentation, so we can learn from the experience of the states, but also just sometimes different states are going to disagree on how to do things, and that's okay. And so on certain policies, we permit that sort of variety in policymaking. But more broadly, what we see with the Constitutional Convention is that the convention will pass a broad resolution that was originally drafted by James Madison in the Virginia Plan at the beginning of the convention, which again sort of is this idea that Congress is gonna have the power to legislate in all instances in which what he said, the states are separately incompetent. So areas where we don't think the states can really handle where we think it's useful to speak with a national voice. And then the convention itself, and most notably through the Committee of Detail, which is an important committee formed 2 months into the convention, then take that big, broad principle drafted by the convention and settle on that list of powers we read at the beginning of Article 1, Section 8, saying these are the things we really think the national government should do. And then ever since that point, Curry, we have argued as Americans as to what can the national government actually do, what can Congress actually do, and then what is left to the states.
Yeah, and there is so much debate. So there is something like kind of okay about it. This pressure and this kind of change and lethargy at time and things not moving is a part of the system. And then we're going to get into at the end kind of those questions around, has it gone too far? Has this slowing down of the process gone too far? And are there guardrails or changes we need to make around that? But we need to kind of walk through really quickly some of these debates over time so we can understand how the powers of Congress have been defined during different time periods so we can understand how to answer that modern question today with all of the information. So these speed round, Tom, walk us through these big issues and these big areas, and then we'll get to that a modern question and say, where are the power and can we do these things?
Absolutely. So yeah, let's take a brisk jog through constitutional history, starting with the period from the founding up to the Civil War. I think the big thing to keep in mind through all these periods is we're talking about big debates over the powers of Congress, where some people are saying Congress has broad powers and others arguing, no, you're going too far and we need to leave some of these decisions to the states. So this period from the founding of the Civil War, from a constitutional perspective, is largely dominated by the Marshall Court. So that's from 1801 to 1835. This is the court that's led by Chief Justice John Marshall. And it's really the Supreme Court that's tasked with the first series of big challenges addressing the powers of Congress. And so the Marshall Court's especially looking at some of the provisions we've already talked about. So it's looking at Congress's power under the Commerce Clause. It's looking at Congress's power under the Necessary and Proper Clause. And really the two most famous cases here are McCulloch v. Maryland and Gibbons versus Ogden. From McCullough v. Maryland, we see the Marshall Court addressing the constitutionality of a national bank. And so this is one where if we look at our Constitution, there's no charter bank clause in there. So Chief Justice Marshall at the very beginning here has to say, does Congress have the power to pass a national bank? And he says, yes. He says, under the necessary and proper clause, the national bank is related enough to a lot of the other powers that Congress has that that's constitutional. And then with Gibbons versus Ogden, we get a fairly broad reading of Congress's commerce power. Taken together, Curry, the big thing we pull from the Marshall Court is that on the one hand, the Constitution does create a Congress of limited powers, but the Marshall Court reads some of those powers, including under the Commerce Clause and the Necessary and Proper Clause, fairly broadly. And in most of these cases, it's recognizing Congress having a role in helping to expand the American economy through the 1800s, playing a role in sort of shaping national economic policy.
And if there's one thing you should remember is you should connect Congress and Commerce Clause a lot in your conversations. It's going to be the theme of the class. Let's talk about, you know, Congress's power getting expanded at the second founding after the Civil War.
Yeah, so these are the three amendments we passed after the Civil War, known as the Reconstruction Amendments. And as Curry said, many scholars refer to it as America's second founding. So this is the 13th Amendment, which abolishes slavery, the 14th Amendment, which promises freedom and equality, and the 15th Amendment, which protects the right to vote free of racial discrimination. For our story, this is really important because these are the first amendments to the Constitution that expand the powers of the national government. Congress has more power than it did before. And what these amendments say is, Congress, you have the power to pass, quote, appropriate legislation to carry out the promises of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. And we've debated what that means, again, sort of ever since.
And so as we kind of move past and see, okay, Congress is, you know, the courts are saying, nope, Congress has power to do these things. They have the power to promote and to increase commerce for the country. They also get even more power to make sure equality and discrimination in voting is checked. Not that they always use it, but they had the power to do it after the Civil War. Then we get into the Lochner era, and I find this unbelievably fascinating, the Lochner era and then looking at the New Deal era, because they almost seem at odds at times with each other.
You know, it's a push and a pull. So Lochner era, most non-constitutional lawyers would refer to this as the Gilded Age and Progressive Era. It's the late 1800s, early 1900s. Constitutional lawyers call it the Lochner era, named after this case, Lochner versus New York from 1905, where the Supreme Court struck down a New York state law regulating the working conditions of bakers. But what's happening during this period, a few things are of note. So if we're looking before this period, so before the Lochner era, before the Gilded Age, before the Civil War, Congress does very little. There isn't a lot, there just isn't a lot of big national legislation. There's some, but not a ton. But as we get to the late 1800s, we see a nation on the move, a nation exploding, an economy changing. We see big railroads, big businesses, changes abound, new dangers for workers. And so we see government at all levels, from Congress to state governments, to local governments, passing more laws and regulations than ever before. There's just more going on at the governmental level. But then we see challengers push back and say, this isn't the America that we know. The government's doing way too much, especially Congress. Maybe some of these things are okay if the state and local governments do them, but Congress, you're taking on more powers than you have before and too many powers. And so we see this push and pull between supporters of government action saying, conditions have changed. Government has to do more to regulate the economy and to protect workers. And we see challengers saying that these laws, especially by Congress, are doing too much. They're unconstitutional. It goes beyond what Congress has under the commerce power and beyond the power Congress has under the Necessary and Proper Clause.
And it really kind of moves this forward. And then we jump to the next era and we look at the New Deal, which there's a lot of laws coming out of the New Deal era. My favorite case, we'll talk about Woodward v. Fillmore, because that one always blows my mind. Even though how many times we've talked about it in our classes at the Constitution Center, it still blows my mind. So can you talk about the New Deal era, what's going on in this time period? And then, you know, again, that push and pull between the time periods and that tension of what is the role of Congress, where are the boundaries, where are there not boundaries?
Yeah, so if the Lochner era was about the Supreme Court setting some new limits on congressional power and trying to really regulate what goes to the national government, what goes to the states. In the New Deal, we see the national government pushing ahead. It's facing the Great Depression, one of the great economic challenges ever. And FDR and the New Deal Congress passed just a ton of new national legislation regulating the economy. Some big programs that we still have today, like Social Security, come out of the New Deal. But what we see is that Congress doing more than it had ever done before to regulate the economy. And initially, we see the Supreme Court push back, you know, and sort of say, no, what you, FDR and Congress, are pushing for, this is beyond your powers under the Commerce Clause. These are beyond your powers under the Necessary and Proper Clause. And so we see early checks on New Deal programs like ALA Schechter Poultry versus United States in 1935, where one of the centerpieces the New Deal is struck down as unconstitutional by the Supreme Court, the National Industrial Recovery Act. But at the same time, then we see, beginning in 1937, the Supreme Court reverses course. And so the Supreme Court begins to uphold many of these New Deal programs. Scholars debate the reasons behind this. Some scholars argue that it's because FDR pushed hard, saying, if you don't change your views, I am going to pack the court with new justices. And so, really seeing it as sort of a real conflict between the president and the Supreme Court. But regardless, we see the Supreme Court turn away from the Lochner era, turn away from the limits on government that we saw during that period, and beginning to read the Constitution's Commerce Power and Necessary and Proper Clause quite broadly. And you're right, Curry, the great symbol of this is the case of Wickard versus Filborn from 1942.
And so Warren asked a really good question, is, was that the function of who was on the court, i.e. Frankfurter?
It was in part. I mean, the big switch in 1937 was based on the views of people who were already sitting on the court. So Justice Owen Roberts, he's known as the quote unquote switch in time that saved nine. He voted to strike down certain laws that were passed by Congress and then reversed course and started to uphold them. So he was the hinge point. But shortly thereafter, we would see some of the justices who were skeptical of the New Deal resign from the court because they were getting older. And they were replaced by FDR appointees like Felix Frankfurter, Hugo Black, William O. Douglas. And then they would uphold a lot of the New Deal programs.
Got it. And that's also a major, I mean, we're talking the Great Depression. We're talking all this social stuff going on at the time too. Now, when you, real quick, Tom, when you do Wickard v. Fillmore, and then we get to the hypothetical, I know you'll balance it with Lopez, but I like to look at them as, you know, bookends in a storyline as well, even though they're really far apart.
Yeah, so Wickard v. Fillmore, it's 1942. Congress has passed the Agricultural Adjustment Act of 1938, which limits the amount of wheat that farmers can grow on their own farms. And so we have Roscoe Fillmore. He's a small farmer. And, you know, he's growing wheat to feed animals on his own farm. So he's not selling this wheat in interstate commerce. He's not selling it to anyone. And so he goes to court and he challenges the Agricultural Adjustment Act, saying, this goes beyond Congress's power. How can this reach me? I am growing wheat, but I'm not selling it anywhere. I'm just feeding my animals with it. How can Congress possibly use its power to reach me? This is like pure intrastate within one state, within one farm activity. How can Congress reach me? But the Supreme Court says, no, Mr. Filburn, you're wrong. You're wrong. In the end, this law is constitutional. And what the Supreme Court says here is, it's true, Mr. Filburn, you are just growing your own wheat, feeding your animals, but your decision to grow your own wheat and not buy it on the open market has a ripple effect on the entire economy. So the right way to think about this is, sure, there's you, but what if everyone did the same thing you did? You would see massive disruptions in the wheat market and the economy. So Congress, and that's a massive interstate market. And so Congress has the power to pass laws to shape that market. But what we see occur is that's a real expansive view of what counts as the commerce power. And from 1942 until 1995, the Supreme Court would not strike down a single law passed by Congress under its commerce power. So the commerce power from 1942 to 1995 is quite broad, and it's the commerce power of Wickard v. Filburn.
And just to clarify, it's under the commerce power. So there was other laws that they struck down, just not the ones that fell under the commerce power, just to clarify for everybody.
Yeah, yeah. So the point is, the Supreme Court used to do a lot to police economic laws, but after Wickard v. Filburn, it basically gets out of the business of that, and it does a lot more of focusing on individual rights, equal protection, those sorts of cases, as opposed to really policing laws passed by Congress to regulate the economy.
Now, there has been some kind of, retraction of that. with the courts late, I shouldn't say lately, 1995. So maybe a beat on Lopez real quick, and then we'll get into the, you know, the constitutionality of some of these questions that we may face in the next 10 years, but also the key question that we ask the students in the beginning of the class, what would be some of the things that they would present as ways to help Congress be more functional, or areas that they say, leave it alone, it's working exactly the way it should? That was kind of the key question of this class.
Okay, yeah, sure. So what we see in recent decades is a Supreme Court that's looking to find some limits on Congress's power. So what we know is under the Constitution, Congress has limited powers. And so we see the Supreme Court trying to figure out, after Wicker v. Filburn, what limits can we put in place? And maybe the most key example is United States versus Lopez from 1995. There, Alfonso Lopez is arrested for carrying his concealed weapon into school. Congress had passed a law called the Gun-Free Schools Act of 1990, banning people from doing that. And so Lopez is prosecuted under this law. And he argues that what in the world is Congress doing passing a law dealing with guns in schools? This has nothing to do with the economy. It has nothing to do with commerce. How can Congress possibly do this under its commerce power? This must exceed Congress's power. And in a 5-4 decision, the Supreme Court agreed with Mr. Lopez. He said that we have reached the outer limit of Congress's power, even under Wicker v. Filburn. Here in the end, this is a non-economic activity that Congress is seeking to regulate. And so when it has no clear connection in the law to interstate commerce, the limit is reached there.
Awesome. Okay. So final question for you, Tom. And, you know, we hear this debate today that Congress isn't working as it should, that it is supposed to be a slow process, but it's at a stalemate because some people say there's other issues in it. Some people say, nope, it's working exactly the way it should. We talked earlier about one of our scholars last week, Jamel Bowie, shared that he thinks that the number of representatives, so how many people a congressperson represents, is too large for the House, that should be smaller. So there's more of a direct connection. So kind of lay out two sides of that argument for us about, you know, we started with how Congress works and what its job is. And I guess the question is Congress working? You know, yay, pro, con, yay or nay?
You know, that's a great question, Curry. And, you know, it's a reminder that, you know, from the founding onward, you know, part of the American constitutional story is all about debates over constitutional and institutional reform. I mean, the founding generation, when they created the U.S. Constitution, they weren't creating it out of thin air on a blank slate. They were trying to learn from experience and try to make the system better than the systems that came before. So these debates over whether Congress is working or not is very much of a piece with the rest of the American constitutional system and some of the great features of it. I mean, I think the two sides here would be, there are certainly going to be a group of people who maybe don't love every way in which Congress functions now, but would say that in the end, it's good to have the constraints on national power. That in the end, you know, it's one thing, sure, there are cases like Lopez, there are, you know, is the Lochner area where we see checks on congressional power, but that the most effective and the most important checks on congressional power are precisely the structural process ones that we talked at the beginning. And so sure, the process is really hard. It takes a lot to get, you know, to pass new national laws, but that's as it should be. And so therefore we want these checks to be in place. So there are plenty of people that would, although not, maybe not love every way in which Congress functions, every debate that happens in Congress, everything Congress does, but would still look at the structure and say, no, it's working as it was intended. Right now, we have a really, really divided public in many ways. We see high levels of polarization and partisanship. They would probably argue that the last thing we want is to have one side just be able to do whatever it wants, and then end up, when another group is elected, have them do everything that they want. And then we have a policy yo-yo going back and forth. So maybe that the best way for Congress to work in the context of a polarized politics is precisely to act as a restraint. So that's one side, that's the status quo side. You know, the reformer side would say, okay, that's fine. But in the end, when the framers put together this new constitution, they weren't just looking for a Congress of limited powers, they were looking for a Congress that worked. You know, if you're looking at the Articles of Confederation that came before the US Constitution, part of the complaint was it required either a supermajority or even a unanimous set of states to do anything. And as a result, the national government simply couldn't function. It couldn't address genuinely national problems. And so they would probably analogize the current situation of gridlock in Congress to something like the Articles of Confederation. And so would argue there you would need ways to not move towards just like any majority could have its way at any particular time it wants. Maybe you would look for certain ways to speed up the system and allow for a bit more action. So again, there's sort of arguments just from constitutional principle and constitutional theory on sort of both sides. And then you could obviously think of like specific reforms that might serve one versus the other.
That was really helpful. And I love, but also scared of the way you aligned it to Articles of Confederation time. But that is a good perspective from that side. So one of the specific ways was somebody shared in the chat, the filibuster. And Fred wanted to know, where did the filibuster come from? Kind of how did it, what's the history behind the filibuster?
Yeah, so Jeff Rosen and I, many years ago, wrote an article for The Atlantic on the history of the filibuster. So I would just sort of recommend looking for that for some of the details. But, you know, it's one of those things where it was initially just a parliamentary rule. So both houses of Congress, under Article 1 of the Constitution, have very broad authority to set the rules of how their proceedings would work. And so the filibuster, and especially the rule of cloture, which closes off debate, it emerged as a parliamentary practice to figure out a way in which how you could stop debate at a particular point in time, as opposed to just having rambling debates go on and on for a period of time. But what we've seen is over time, the filibuster has functions more as a supermajority requirement in the United States Senate. It's less about sort of what the contours of debate are going to be like, rather than saying that if the Senate is going to pass a law, in most cases, if it's an important law, you're going to have 60 senators. But in the end, it's under the authority of the majority of the Senate to set the rules that are in place for any particular point in time. And so it's sort of under those powers that we give each body of Congress to set how the proceedings are going to work.
Awesome. Thank you, Tom. And I appreciate that you just assigned us Tom homework. So we're all going to read it tonight, too. So I'm going to send that out to everybody. And we'll make sure it's in the Friday wrap-up as well. Great conversation, Tom. Thank you so much for playing what's working, what's not working with us when looking at Congress and how stuff works. Always my favorite classes when we really break down not just the constitutional theory, but also the practice of it, because those two go hand in hand like a two-sided coin. So thank you so much for a great class. Students, thank you for awesome questions in there. That was really helpful. And talk to everybody soon. Oh, we will have Gary Larson on class on Friday. So that will be our VIP speaker if you want to join in with us on Friday, and we can ask him a million questions too. That's what our job is.
He's great.
Yeah, exactly.
That'll be fun.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you, everyone.